Good morning, BSides San Antonio. I am so happy to be with you again this year for the second year, I believe. This is my talk, Sucky Job Ads Don't Matter. So first of all, who am I? And who I am and what my journey has included be relevant to you with regard specifically to job descriptions and helping you, whether you are actively searching or passively looking or maybe even hiring. I think this will give helpful information to all of the parties mentioned. I am the senior recruiting director at Nevada, an advanced analytics and cybersecurity products and services firm. If you Google us, by the way, got on my Nevada Pride shirt today, you'll see that we recently announced that we are being acquired by Accenture Federal Services, which is going to be a great new adventure for us. When I talk about career changes and new adventures and specifically how I and how you can change within your career, I hope that this will all help not only people who are struggling when they see terrible job descriptions, but also help you when you're trying to figure out how to advance from one specific area to another business area, or break into cyber, as many people often try to figure out how to do. A lot of that starts at the job description. So for me personally, I have moved around quite a bit. I have been at Nevada for almost 5 years. And again, I'm going to be helping to build a new business unit within Accenture Federal Services very soon. So yay for that. I am a college dropout that is relevant to this discussion, and started my career in the early 90s, started with software development. Well, I went from a front desk person to a software developer to running, managing, and building help desks. To realizing, oh my gosh, you know what I think? I think building the teams is not just what I'm really good at, but it's really fun. So that I got into recruiting, and I've been the director for, again, about 5 years. So my speaking engagements, I gave a few examples. ShmooCon was my first one. Then I did Derby, DEF CON Career Village last year, many, many B-sides. And BSides San Antonio is accommodating me today. You're watching a pre-recorded talk. I'm actually traveling right now when you see this for a family thing that I had to do. So, and I mentioned TorCon just because I love San Diego and I love TorCon. So those are a few of the talks I've done. And again, this one is going to be focused on job descriptions. I see you talking about them. I know it's a problem. I know it's discouraging. I know it's disappointing. Let's get through how to turn every time you see a job post into a positive experience and what to do from there. So I will again try to give you examples from my personal story and how that could potentially relate to you, how I have frankly gotten jobs I wasn't qualified for, including the one I have now, at least not on paper. And hopefully I can help you to do the same thing. So the agenda is going to be, okay, once you see this job description, what does that mean for you? What should you do? What should your plan be? It should be how to build your own requirements. When I say requirements, every job description should be written in a very specific way, according to OFCCP. The employer has to break that description into what is required as opposed to what is preferred. Every requirement should be a measurable, quantifiable, bona fide occupational qualification. We will talk about how often you will see that they're not giving you good qualifications. They're mixing up what should be preferred and what should be required. Are they giving you judgmental things that is hard to quantify and hard for you to respond to? So we'll talk a little bit about the questions you should ask and how you can respond to those things that don't make sense. And I get it. You're going to say, wait a second, entry level with a CISSP and a PhD and 20 years of experience? I mean, come on. So listen, we will also talk about why sometimes it happens. Yes, stupidity. Yes, laziness. Yes, sometimes that's the answer. There's also a couple other reasons why it happens. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the why, but I'm going to help you try to get past that as well. Talk about the blockers, get you to the interview table. We want this discussion to bring you from the job ad, how that becomes an opportunity for you, the project you're going to do. I'm going to task you with a little bit of homework when you see job ads, when you're looking. And this is also going to give some pointers again to the employers, who they should be partnering with and how they should be doing their job posts. And again, how this is going to get you to the interview. So think about every job ad that you see as an opportunity. It's going to be a little project for you. It's not going to be as hard as it sounds. I'm not going to make you into a full-fledged stalker here, but there's so much abundance of information available to us all, right? That's the world we live in now. There's plenty of information available to you. So let's go from the job ad, regardless of the quality of the job ad. How can you get from that job ad a look into the company's culture? And we'll start with, okay, I am currently in this business area. I'm a contracts manager. I want to get into information security. And I think I really want to get into incident response. I think that's the direction I want to go in. So I'm going to do a little search. By the way, I've had people say you have to have paid accounts, you have to have primary premium accounts. You don't. They're wrong when they tell you that. Is it helpful? Sure. Will it hurt you? No. But there's so much information already available to you. Good recruiters are going to find you whether you have a premium account or not. I don't have to spend the time and the money doing that. You can go to Google, you can go to LinkedIn, Indeed, Glassdoor, whatever. When you see the job post, this is now when I give you the assignment to do a little bit of research. You're going to say, okay, ABC company is looking for, what did I say, incident response, looking for an IR person. That's what I want to do. That's what I'm interested in doing. So what does the culture of this company look like? If they're a good company, they have recruiting and ops and marketing all closely partnering with each other so that they're all on the same page, so that they are doing the right messaging to find the right people. Because let's face it, the companies need to hire people. They need to either sell stuff or they need to provide a service. And you need people in order to get that done. So they should be partnering closely. They should be putting the right messages out there. If you spent any time on social media over the last couple of months, you saw an organization that I don't know if somebody was trying to be cute or clever or what they were trying to do, but they put a little survey out and they were trying to look woke. I don't know what they're trying to do, but they messed up. The community responded. They paid attention to what was being said, to what was offensive, and to the response from the organization. So again, really important for that partnership to be there so that the right messaging is going out, starting with the job ad and every post that you put out that would direct potential customers and candidates to your company and to your opportunities. What does the culture look like there? What are they saying on social? What are they putting out? What are they showing you about themselves? What do the pictures look like? Who's there? What are they doing? Does it interest you? Do you want to do those things? Is that something that you're interested in being a part of? Is it a fit for you? And when you look at who works there, I'm not saying stalk every single person that works there, but look at two or three people with the job title, either in the job posting that you saw or the type of position you're interested in doing yourself. You're going to look at their professional profile. They should have one. Hopefully they do. And you're going to also look at their social footprint. And again, I'm not saying you're going to become a full-on stalker. Don't go to their Facebook page. Leave them alone. But do this. See if they're talking on Twitter. Twitter is an opportunity for people to talk about their day, talk about how do they talk to and about their coworkers, their boss. What do they say about what they're learning, what they're doing, what opportunities have been given to them, flexibility that's been given to them, an opportunity, did they get a cert? Cool. Was it a sans cert? Wow, that's expensive. Who paid for it? Is this a company that I can grow at and I can get those opportunities at? Again, what does the culture look like? Who's doing the work there that you're interested in doing? How are they talking about their days? Let's face it. We talk about the food we eat. We talk about the sports teams that we like, and we talk about our jobs. It's what we do. Some of us talk about our kids. I talk about my dog, whatever. People are giving away, whether they mean to or not, good and bad testimony about how they spend. Listen, we all spend a good chunk of our days working. So that's the kind of thing that you're going to see if you just spend a couple minutes looking at social. So what are these people saying, and how have they progressed in their careers? This is important. So you can use me for an example. This person was all over the place. They did this and then this and then this. Did they make those moves within the same organization? Did they have to leave in order to grow or in order to change? That's important. It's also important that, frankly, for me, I'm a good example of someone who wasn't qualified for, again, not just this job, but it wasn't like I had programming experience or help desk management experience or recruiting experience when I transitioned and pivoted into those different business areas. So we're going to talk about, well, how the heck did you do it then? I didn't go get the training. I didn't get experience. I found other avenues. So we'll talk about that. So are they advancing on their professional profile when you look at it, when they're moving around, and what is the pattern that you're picking up? Okay, ABC company, it looks like everyone with this job title stays in that slot for a period of time and then leaves. That seems to be the pattern. Or I see them starting here and moving up. Cool, that's a cool story. It's a cool pattern for you to discover. You're gonna rate these things, right? You're gonna go in there, you're going to do a little bit of research, and then you're going to come up with your top companies based on what you're discovering by looking at the people that work there. I do have a couple disclaimers real quick. Not because I'm a mind reader, but because I think I know what questions you're going to ask because I've been asked them before. So I hear you saying, but don't they sometimes write a job description specifically targeting one person or one small group of people? Yes. And I've done it, not my current employer, but I have done it. I'll give you an example, and this goes way back. I'm not going to say the tool because then you'll know who the people are. But I was at a company that specifically wanted at least one of the people who developed a specific tool. Now, in this instance, at that time, there was five people, let's say, you can count on one hand the people on the team that built that tool. I did later see someone else looking for people with experience with that tool, and they said, minimum 10 years experience with blah. It hadn't existed that long. What? So all being said, I did end up hiring a couple of those people. By the way, at them at DEF CON. That's how that happened. So yay, networking, yay events. It works, but the job description was written for them. Let's just say the lead developer's name was Jane. And they specifically wanted her. So what if you can't find her? What if she's not available? There's a good chance that's not going to happen. This is where the candidate and the employer need to take it a step further. And you are your own best advocate. You're the expert on you. You know what you like. You know what you do. If you can find a good recruiter, and I hope you can, because good companies have good recruiters, that recruiter is going to make the whole experience about you, finding out about you, finding out what you like, what you want, what you do, what you have done, what you'd like to do, and becoming an advocate for you, becoming an agent for you, speaking for you to get you from that applicant stage to the interview table. They need to get you there by speaking well for you. So you got to speak well for yourself and get a recruiter, a person, an agent who is going to do a good job delivering you to the people that make the hiring decision. So enough about those job descriptions that are written specifically for people. However, if you're not Jane, then does that mean you can't get the job? It means that you have to look at that description. You have to figure out how much of your willingness and ability to figure that stuff out you can deliver. And a good company is going to recognize that and appreciate that. I will only spend a moment on this next thing, what you should run away from. These are real job descriptions. Thank you, by the way, to everyone who responded to my tweet and sent in horrible job descriptions. I get it. I'm sorry. I am sorry that it happens. But thank you for those examples. I'm not sharing all of them. I picked one description. I won't say who it's from, but we'll get to it in a little bit. And I was hoping to animate all the questions that pop into my head if I'm the candidate when I see those descriptions, but I ended up just writing it all out. I will show you, these are not funny. I'm not going to read them to you because they're offensive, but these are real. And hopefully I redacted everything that would tell you who these people are. But if you see something, I don't know if they're trying to be cute or funny. I don't know what the heck they're trying to do here. But if you don't waste your time, if they screwed up this bad, just run away. Run away from these dirty. Okay. So back to your requirements. So the job post is indicative, likely, of at the very least that this is a company that's hiring or they were hiring. So you're going to build your own requirements list. Remember, we talked about how the job description should be broken down between what is a requirement and what is a preferred skill. I need you to do that. I need you to have at least two or three columns where you're going to start by figuring out what you need versus want versus would be kind of groovy to have. And you can rate as you're looking through those people that are posting and you're doing your research on those companies, you can rate them according to what looks like it's going to match up to as many of the things that are important to you as possible. That could be flexibility. It could be schedule. It could be ability to work remotely, room and opportunities to grow. Remember, we talked about how you could identify those things based on what it looks like is a pattern for the people that previously or currently work there. How does it appear as though they're providing opportunities? Is their marketing department showing you a lot of cool things that are happening that you'd like to be involved with? Are they sponsoring cool events? Are they providing training? Are they advertising that a lot of people are getting certifications there? This is cool stuff. Think about things that are deal breakers for you too. If they're just getting involved in things that are not a fit for you, you know, have high standards. Pretend that, you know, this is I have likened to what I imagine dating would be like. You got to keep trying. You got to keep your standards high, and you have to figure out what really matters most to you so that this could end up being a long, happy relationship when you get your next thing. Rank and proceed. So this job description Gotta put on my glasses to see it. So let's go through just real quick. I just did the quals and desired. And we could figure out how many of these things we should scoot down, right? Like, so a lot of what they're putting in the basic quals, they fail to provide in each bullet. That's a lot. They really need to move some of those basic quals down into desired, or they need to further define how they are quantifying and measuring these things. But let's start with the first one. Polly, do you mean counterintelligence? Do you mean CI? Do you mean full scope? What kind of poly are we talking about here? I get that you can't tell me who the customer is, but which one do you mean? It matters. And do you mean active or do you mean eligible? Do you mean somebody who passed the poly 3 years ago and they're still in that window? Or these are reasonable questions for you. So when I walk through the bullets, and I could have put a question next to almost every single one of them, but when you see a bullet that raises a flag or causes a question for you, that doesn't mean stop. It means write it down. And again, I told you that a good employer or potential employer is going to have a recruiting team that is going to either find out the answers for you. They're 100% going to spend the time listening to your concerns, and then they will either know the answers or find out the answers for you. In this case, like I said, you're wondering, okay, what do you mean by poly? Ask the question. Does comparable experience count for bachelor's? In my current case, if it hadn't, I wouldn't be here in every other job I've had. So that's an important question too. If I hadn't met the CEO of my current company at Black Hat because of a networking connection, and I had seen the job posting, I probably would not have applied for it because on paper, I don't qualify. So moving on. I have an example for everything, but okay, when you say all these forensics tools, do you also mean, does Wireshark count? I mean, it's open source, right? Does it count? I don't know. I hate the way they grouped all these programming and scripting languages together. C and C++, well, they're not the same. Okay, so you talk about Python and Perl and Java, that's a bunch of scripting. I have scripted. I've never written an executable file from scratch. So that's very different from scripting. Does it count because you put it all together? What do you mean here? Are you looking for several different people at all these different levels of experience or different types of experience? Or do I have to have the operating level experience and the scripting? Like, come on, you shouldn't have grouped it all together like that. So write it down, ask the question, and be able to speak to what you have done and what you are willing to do and what you are capable of learning, having had learned it before. I hate that it says deep understanding. What the heck does that mean? Are you measuring that with a ruler scale? What? Ask the question. And then when they kind of like, again, strong, what does strong mean? Shame on whoever wrote this. This is bad. This is not compliant and it's confusing. So there's a lot to unpack in the last bullet under quals where it says good interpersonal, strong initiative, problem solving, organizational what? Writing, communication, and briefing skills. That's a lot. So I wouldn't address every single one of those things. This is where this gives you the opportunity to tell a story, I guess. Well, with regard to interpersonal skills, I'm leading a team call every 2 weeks. And as far as initiative goes, I started a research project, which ended up turning into a solution for the customer, hence problem solving. You can talk about things that you've written. You can talk about any communications that you do regularly. I write a newsletter once a month. There's just a lot to unpack here, but this is an opportunity for you when you get to the interview table, after talking to the recruiter, to have stories ready that refer to these different types of skills. there are different levels of certs, and some certs are harder than others and some are more expensive than others. This is an opportunity for you to figure out if the comparable certifications count, or if some of these are deal breakers. And I will say sometimes the end customer is the one who they wrote the SAO and it says must have this. Okay, are you giving the opportunity or providing the training or the budget to get those things? Do I need to write off the bat? So again, this is an opportunity for you to ask questions. So I already mentioned all these different types of blockers that you will identify within the job posting, whether or not you have the educational requirements, certifications, and training and so forth. Recruiters are going to be a big key for you. If you're super interested in a company and recruiting is, I don't know, dropping the ball or making mistakes or not getting your questions answered, you can take it a step further. You can, first of all, if they're not answering your application, that's just a volume problem. I was super guilty of that back when I was recruiting. This is where you're going to go to LinkedIn. Every recruiter worth salt is on there. They're there and they're listening to and they're answering their messaging is there. You can go directly to anyone that looks like they're in a management position at the company as well and say, hey, I sent Steven a message as the recruiter on this position. I haven't heard anything, really interested in hearing back. Let me know if there's anything you need from me, blah, blah, blah. So take the time to, you know, to do the messaging on LinkedIn and see if you can get through that way. So again, listen, events, can't say enough about it. Hey, guess what? Congrats. You all took the step. You're all here. If you're watching this, then you already did the first step. You're at an event. I wish that I must have written this months ago. Okay, COVID is looking hopeful that it's coming to a close here, or that we're at least in a much better place than we were when I did this a year ago. Events, I can't say enough good stuff about them. I do hope, and I am hopeful that events will be doing what DEF CON and BSides, right, Black Hat are doing this year. They are offering the hybrid opportunity. I hope they continue that forever. Frankly, at different times in our lives, we have different budget and availability for traveling. We can't all jump on planes all the time. So offering the hybrid option is fantastic. I will say that Car Hacking Village, we were doing it before it was a thing. we were already committed to doing it this year. So if you come to DEF CON, you can see us either way, virtually or in person. But again, I'm really excited about this being the way of the future and the way that we continue to offer different events for everyone so that they can do it. Cannot say enough good stuff about mock interviews and resume workshops. I can't say for certain that it was invented by Kathleen Smith, but if you're not connected to her, you need to rectify that. She definitely is the first person I ever heard of mock interviews and resume workshops from. And she dedicates a giant portion of her life. It's amazing. To setting these things up at various conferences. It is happening here at BSides San Antonio today. At most BSides have these available. The mock interviews is going to not just help you practice and get better at selling yourself, but it'll help you also be a better interviewer. It's just a really great opportunity for you to be like, wait, let me rephrase that. Wait, let me start over. And if the coaches that are providing the experience, they're not just recruiters, they're hiring managers and engineers too, and people that have been on both sides of the table that can really help you rephrase things and relook at things and say, hold on, what did you mean by that? I can't say enough good stuff about it. If you've never done it, give it a shot as a volunteer or as a participant or both. So do the mock interviews, do the resume workshops. Resume workshops are fantastic. If you think about it, when you're going through, remember when we were on that horrible job description or that not super awesome job description? The further along you get in your experience, and even if you're just starting out, there's going to be, you should take the time to customize your resume. I'm not saying you have to rewrite it every single time, but compare it to the job description and try to pick out the things like we were talking about, all those different languages where you might say, well, heck, I didn't see objective on there, but I did a training class in objective, or I did a project, or I used it on a CTF, or I wrote a thing on the side, whatever the case may be. When you notice the things in the job description that you either want to address that you have, or that you have something similar to, this is your opportunity to customize your resume, to push those things up to the top. And the resume workshops is going to be a really good opportunity for you to say, and maybe go in there with not just your resume, but with the job description and say, hey, coach, help me line these things up. So all of these things here at BSides, the things that I'm mentioning here on this slide, these are all networking opportunities. Again, I mentioned I got this job and several of my positions through networking, not by answering a job description. So this is the part where normally I would be taking your questions live. And because, as I mentioned, I'm probably in a car right now, or I'm far away. My DMs are open as long as everybody stays nice. My DMs will remain open on Twitter. I am KRenner, or you can hit me up on LinkedIn. I always respond. If I can't help you, if I can't give you the attention that you deserve, at the very least, I will introduce you to someone who absolutely can help you. Again, KRenner on Twitter. I'm Kirsten Renner. This is my take on how to get past bad job descriptions. And again, thank you so much, BSides San Antonio, for accommodating me, for giving me this opportunity. And I hope everyone has a great day and good luck in your journey. Thanks.